Welcome to this presentation. This will be a lecture on perinatal psychiatry. The term perinatal refers to the period before and after childbirth. The World Health Organization, in its definition of perinatal mortality, includes the period from the end of the 22nd week of pregnancy up to 7 days postpartum. For the purpose of this lecture, the term perinatal will include the whole of pregnancy and a postpartum period of 1 year. I have done so as this will enable discussion of the use of psychotropic medication during the whole of pregnancy, especially the first trimester, and of postpartum psychiatric disorders that may persist for up to several months. This would be the lecture outline. First, we will cover some general issues regarding pregnancy and psychiatric disorders. Then we will go through three postpartum psychiatric disorders: postpartum psychosis, postnatal depression, and maternity blues. For each postpartum disorder, we will look at epidemiology, clinical features, management, and outcome. Then we will look at how postpartum disorders are covered in ICD-10 and DSM-5. Finally, we will go through the important, controversial, and still incompletely understood issue of prescribing psychotropics during pregnancy and lactation. We will conclude the presentation with a set of 5 multiple choice questions based on the material covered. First, we look at pregnancy and psychiatric disorders. It used to be thought that pregnancy had a protective effect against major mental illnesses. But the general consensus now is that pregnant women are at risk of major mental illnesses, both new onset and recurrence. There do not appear to be any major differences in the prevalence of bipolar, depressive, and non-affective psychotic disorders during pregnancy compared to other times in a woman's life. It is possible that depression during pregnancy may be underdiagnosed. Somatic symptoms of depression may be misattributed to pregnancy. This is probably balanced by the more active screening for and greater detection of depression during pregnancy. There is some suggestion that the prevalence of obsessive-compulsive disorder is increased and the prevalence of generalized anxiety disorder is reduced during pregnancy. The incidence of major eating disorders during pregnancy is significantly lower than at other times. Binge eating and pica are increased in pregnancy. Anorexia nervosa is associated with reduced fertility. If the delivery is very traumatic and complicated, post-traumatic stress disorder can develop postnatally. Overall, women with schizophrenia have lower fertility compared to both general population controls and women with bipolar disorder. Prolactin-raising antipsychotics, which reduce fertility, may partly explain the reduction in fertility rate in such patients. As the onset of schizophrenia is later in women, many female patients have children compared to male patients. Unplanned pregnancies are more common in bipolar disorder. Valproate is associated with polycystic ovary syndrome, which can reduce fertility. Carbamazepine, by its enzyme-inducing effect, can reduce the effectiveness of contraceptives, both oral as well as injection, resulting in unplanned pregnancies. Pregnant patients with severe mental illness during pregnancy may be disadvantaged in several ways. Inability or unwillingness to access or adhere to proper antenatal obstetric care, social and economic disadvantages, more physical comorbidity, for example, metabolic syndrome due to lifestyle, medication side effects, etc. The above can all lead to adverse obstetric and neonatal outcomes. Major mental illnesses, especially depression during pregnancy, have been associated with reduced birth weight, preterm birth, emotional, behavioral, and developmental problems in the offspring. The association number 3 may be mediated by shared genetic risk factors, psychological factors such as insecure attachment, social factors such as a stressful home environment, and long-term effects of exposures in utero, either mother's use of prescribed medication like psychotropics or nicotine or alcohol during pregnancy. While the incidence of suicide during pregnancy seems to be lower than at other times, suicide is an important cause of maternal mortality in the year after childbirth. Compared to non-perinatal suicide, women who commit suicide in the perinatal period are younger, more likely to be married, have shorter duration of depression before suicide, are less likely to have received treatment for depression, and are less likely to have comorbid alcohol misuse. Now we will look at the different postpartum psychiatric disorders. Postpartum psychosis, postnatal depression, and maternity blues, also called postpartum blues or baby blues. The older names for postpartum psychosis include amentia, mania lactea, puerperal insanity, and puerperal mania. The incidence of postpartum psychosis is about 0.2%, so 1 in every 500 births. Postpartum psychosis is considered a psychiatric emergency which needs to be recognized swiftly and managed safely and effectively. The onset is usually within the first 2 weeks postpartum, with about 50% having onset within the first week itself. The onset is typically acute with sudden deterioration, restlessness, irritability, severe mood lability, disorganized behavior, delusions, hallucinations, and poor insight. Symptoms which have an organic feel, such as confusion, disorientation, perplexity, visual, tactile, and olfactory hallucinations are more common in postpartum psychosis compared to psychosis occurring at other times. There may be wide fluctuation in the intensity of symptoms. Catatonic features like stupor or excitement may be seen. Insomnia is usually severe. Insomnia is also a potential trigger for postpartum psychosis in predisposed women, for example, patients who have a history of bipolar disorder. In patients with a past history of mental illness, postpartum psychosis most commonly occurs in those with a diagnosis of bipolar disorder. In some patients, postpartum psychosis may be the first episode of a long-term mental disorder that then recurs in the future. Psychotic symptoms are mood incongruent in about two-thirds of patients with postpartum psychosis. In contrast, psychotic symptoms in non-postpartum depression or bipolar disorder are usually mood congruent. What are the risk factors for postpartum psychosis? Primiparity, history of postpartum psychosis during an earlier childbirth, past history of bipolar disorder or a psychotic illness, a family history of postpartum psychosis, bipolar disorder or a psychotic illness. There is no clear or consistent association with obstetric complications such as preeclampsia when primiparity is controlled for. Psychosocial factors do not seem to be as important as at other times. Biological hypotheses have been offered, including hormonal, immunological, genetic, and neurodevelopmental theories. Postpartum psychosis, especially with prominent depressive features, is associated with risk of both infanticide and maternal suicide, even after the mother has seemingly improved. Hence, assessment should try to identify any risks that the mother poses to the baby and to herself. Symptoms of concern include command hallucinations, where the mother hears voices ordering her to either harm herself or her baby. Delusions involving the baby, where the mother is convinced that the child is evil, possessed, malformed, or that the child should be saved from this cruel world. Passivity phenomena, where the mother believes or experiences as if her thoughts, actions, etc. are being controlled by an outside person or force. Current suicidal ideation or a past history of suicidal attempts, current unpredictable behavior, and a past history of aggression. Over the years, the proportion of patients having only pure postpartum psychosis, that is, patients who do not have any episodes outside the postpartum period, has been declining. This suggests that in the past, some organic causes have been missed while making a wrong diagnosis of postpartum psychosis. So, it is important to consider the possibility of medical causes like delirium due to infections such as endometritis or mastitis, acute thyroid dysfunction, for example, postpartum thyroiditis, before concluding that the patient has postpartum psychosis. Hence, a thorough physical examination and baseline physical investigations are important. Do a full psychiatric, including risk assessment. Depending on the primary psychotic presentation, whether it is manic, depressive, mixed, or non-affective, pharmacological treatment usually involves one or more of the following: antipsychotic, mood stabilizer, antidepressant. The patient is also likely to need benzodiazepines and/or hypnotics. Breastfeeding may need to be suspended depending on the medication that is being used. The mother and her baby need to be closely monitored. If symptoms are very severe and/or if there are prominent risks, admission may be necessary, if available to a mother and baby unit. Electroconvulsive therapy is indicated in treatment-resistant psychosis with prominent affective features, extremely severe depressive or manic psychosis with immediate potential risks to the safety of the mother and/or baby, catatonic stupor. ECT is usually rapidly effective if used appropriately. Overall, the prognosis is good, with most patients achieving remission. The median duration of postpartum psychosis is about 6 weeks. If it is a predominantly depressive psychosis, there tends to be both a later onset or recognition of the psychosis and a slower recovery. There is a better long-term prognosis if postpartum psychosis is due to a mood disorder rather than due to a non-affective psychosis like schizophrenia. Some patients with postpartum psychosis only have recurrences in the postpartum period after future pregnancies. A patient with postpartum psychosis as a first psychotic episode has at least a 25% chance of recurrence of postpartum psychosis after a subsequent childbirth. This risk increases to up to 50% in those with an additional family history of postpartum psychosis. A patient with postpartum psychosis in the context of bipolar disorder also has up to a 50% chance of postpartum psychosis after a subsequent childbirth. This risk can be significantly reduced by prophylactic medication during pregnancy and during the postpartum period. A patient with a history of postpartum psychosis only, without any non-puerperal psychotic episodes, may benefit from prophylactic medication in the early postpartum period after future pregnancies. Berging et al. Reported a case series regarding the management of first episode postpartum psychosis in Holland. Patients with first episode postpartum psychosis were admitted to an inpatient mother and baby unit in Rotterdam and were treated as per a sequential psychopharmacological protocol. The first step was a benzodiazepine, usually lorazepam, given for 3 days. If there was no response, an antipsychotic, either haloperidol or an atypical antipsychotic, was added for 2 weeks. if there was remission, the benzodiazepine was discontinued and the antipsychotic was continued as maintenance treatment. If there was no remission at step 2, lithium was added, and if there was remission, the antipsychotic was discontinued and lithium was continued as maintenance. In this study, there were a total of 64 patients, of whom 63 achieved remission by step 3. So 4 achieved remission at step 1, 12 at step 2, and 47 out of the remaining 48 achieved remission at step 3. No patient needed electroconvulsive therapy, and about 80% of these patients were still in remission at 9 months. So this shows that postpartum psychosis has a good prognosis, but it should be noted that this study is only on first episode postpartum psychosis. We will now move on to postnatal depression. The incidence of postnatal depression estimates vary in different studies. Overall, about 10 to 15% develop postnatal depression. It usually begins after 2 weeks following childbirth. In postpartum psychosis, onset is usually within 2 weeks. The incidence of depression is higher in the first 6 months postpartum compared to other times in a woman's life. But some of this may be delayed diagnosis of depression dating back to the antenatal period or even pre-pregnancy. Compared to depression at other times, in postnatal depression, low mood may not be the most prominent feature. The main symptoms may instead be irritability, fearfulness, anxiety, including fears about both one's own as well as the baby's health, tiredness, anhedonia, excessive guilt, feeling inadequate with respect to one's ability to look after the baby properly, insomnia or hypersomnia, and reduced appetite. The risk factors for postnatal depression include a previous history of depression, depression during pregnancy or anxiety symptoms during pregnancy, younger age, multiple births, increased parity, domestic violence, poor marital relationship, lack of social support, lower levels of education, history of miscarriage, binge eating during pregnancy. Postnatal depression may be more common in low and middle income countries. The Edinburgh Postnatal Depression Scale, or the EPDS, is the most widely used screening tool for postnatal depression. It is a self-rating scale with 10 items pertaining to the previous 7 days. It can be used for up to 12 weeks after pregnancy. It is also used to screen for depression during pregnancy. Interestingly, none of the 10 items pertains to pregnancy or delivery or breastfeeding. It has been adapted, translated, and validated in many cultures and languages. Each item is rated on a scale of 0 to 3, so a maximum score of 30 is possible and the minimum score of 0. A score of 13 or more usually warrants a psychiatric assessment. As with other depression rating scales, the EPDS does not distinguish between unipolar and bipolar depression. In this slide, I have given 3 of the 10 items in the EPDS. Those who are interested can pause and note down the details. Regarding the management of postnatal depression, it is important to do a thorough psychiatric, including risk assessment. If PND is likely, it needs to be treated as it can have an adverse impact on mother-baby bonding. It is important to identify and address relevant psychological and social factors. Providing social support, such as parenting assistance, can be beneficial for those lacking such support within their family or friend networks. Non-pharmacological treatment, if available, should be considered first. If mild, consider simpler options like supportive counseling. If persistent, formal psychotherapy, usually cognitive behavior therapy, either individual or group, would be indicated. If symptoms are persistent or severe, or if suitable psychotherapy is not available, antidepressant treatment may be necessary. When choosing an antidepressant, consider the following: whether it is safe to continue breastfeeding, patient concerns regarding side effects such as weight gain, any previous episodes of depression, the severity, response to treatment, etc. If the patient has a history of bipolar disorder, antidepressants may provoke a manic episode and so need to be used with extreme caution. Majority of patients with postnatal depression make a good recovery, but up to 25% may have some residual symptoms at 1 year. If postnatal depression is the first episode of depression, there is up to 50% chance of another depressive episode. There is no strong evidence to support the use of hormones or nutritional supplements like omega-3 fatty acids, either for the prevention or treatment of postnatal depression. Maternity blues is seen in up to 3/4 of women after childbirth. It occurs almost exclusively during the first postpartum week. Symptoms typically start on day 3 postpartum and spontaneously resolve within the next few days. The symptoms of maternity blues include brief spells of crying, labile mood, insomnia, decreased concentration, feeling confused, feeling distant or separate from the baby, anxiety, and irritability. In contrast to postnatal depression, symptoms of maternity blues occur in episodic bouts rather than being persistent. Symptoms are of mild severity. The mother's ability to care for her child is not impaired. Features like worthlessness, hopelessness, suicidal thoughts, etc. are not present. Symptoms resolve within a few days. Risk factors for maternity blues include primiparity, history of exaggerated fears about delivery, history of premenstrual tension, history of anxiety or depressive symptoms during the third trimester of pregnancy. Hormonal changes, especially the sudden fall in estrogen and progesterone levels, after childbirth have been postulated as playing a major role in maternity blues. Sodium imbalance has been suggested as a possible contributor. Psychological and relationship factors may also play a part. Examples: fears that one would not be a good enough mother, unsupportive husband or an unhappy marriage, unwanted or an unplanned pregnancy. Maternity blues does not appear to be related to obstetric complications. Maternity blues almost always resolve spontaneously within a few days, so there is no treatment needed apart from reassuring the patient and the partner and family. Some patients may develop postnatal depression after 2 weeks, which would then need treatment in its own right. In this slide, I have highlighted the key differences between postpartum psychosis, postnatal depression, and maternity blues in terms of incidence, onset, symptoms, and treatment options. Those who are interested can pause and note down the details. We will now briefly look at how postpartum disorders are dealt with in ICD-10 and DSM-5. Neither ICD-10 nor DSM-5 includes separate diagnostic criteria for postpartum disorders like postnatal depression and postpartum psychosis. In ICD-10, there is a category F53, which is for mental and behavioral disorders associated with the puerperium that is not elsewhere classified. It allows categorization into mild or severe. However, if symptoms satisfy criteria for a diagnosis that is classified elsewhere, then that diagnosis should be given. So, a manic episode occurring in the postpartum period would be given the code F30 and not F53. Similarly, a depressive episode occurring postnatally should be given the code F32 and not F53. And F53 is within the subdivision that includes the codes F50 to F59, behavioral syndromes associated with physiological disturbances and physical factors. This section includes eating disorders, non-organic sleep disorders, sexual dysfunction, etc. The category F53 can only be used if the onset is within 6 weeks postpartum. In DSM-5, a postpartum onset specifier can be added if the onset of symptoms is within 4 weeks postpartum and the patient's features satisfy criteria for either a major depressive disorder, bipolar disorder, or a brief psychotic disorder. We will now look at the controversial but important topic of psychotropics in pregnancy and lactation. The main concern with prescribing medication during pregnancy is teratogenicity. A teratogen is an agent that can cause congenital abnormalities in the newborn. Examples of teratogens are thalidomide, phenytoin, and isoid tretinoin. So during pregnancy, it is important to avoid potential teratogens, especially during the first trimester when organogenesis occurs. The main concern with prescribing medication during lactation is whether the drug passes into the breast milk in significant levels to cause side effects in the infant. So during lactation, it is important to either avoid drugs that pass into the breast milk in significant levels, or if such a medication is really needed, to avoid breastfeeding the infant. There are some general principles regarding prescribing psychotropics in the perinatal period. So avoid if possible, give lowest effective dose, avoid polypharmacy. It is important to do a risk-benefit analysis for each patient. So you have to consider the benefits of taking the drug, risks of taking the drug, benefits of not taking the drug, and the risks of not taking the drug. So I've given some examples for each. Those who are interested can pause and note down the details. Tricyclics and SSRIs seem to be similar in terms of safety in pregnancy. As the side effect profile of SSRIs is generally better, they are usually the first choice if an antidepressant is needed. As a group, antidepressants may be associated with minor risks of spontaneous abortion, postpartum hemorrhage, preterm birth, reduced birth weight, reduced Apgar scores, increased risk of congenital cardiac malformation. This risk has been particularly associated with paroxetine, persistent pulmonary hypertension in the newborn. Neonatal behavioral problems, which have been called neonatal adaptation or withdrawal syndrome, and include irritability, crying, eating and sleeping difficulties, respiratory distress syndrome in the neonate, delays in motor development, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and autism spectrum disorder in the offspring. However, it is important to note that the above risks are not consistent findings. There are contradictory studies, with only some suggesting these risks, while others concluding that these risks are not raised. Even in studies showing an increase in relative risks, the absolute risks are still quite low. Overall, antidepressants seem to be safe in a mother who is breastfeeding her infant, but adverse effects have been reported and include respiratory depression with doxepine, which is a tricyclic, irritability with fluoxetine, and sleep or feeding difficulties generally. For the same antidepressant dose, the exposure of the neonate to the drug is much lower than the exposure of the fetus to the drug during pregnancy. It has been suggested that sertraline may be the antidepressant of choice during lactation in patients with no past history of antidepressant treatment, considering its low level of transfer into breast milk. However, if a patient has a history of good response to another antidepressant in the past, then consider that as first line in the postpartum period if it is safe. Antipsychotics taken during pregnancy may be associated with gestational diabetes mellitus, especially seen with olanzapine and clozapine, small for gestational age, large for gestational age, macrosomia, preterm births, low birth weight, increase in congenital malformations, including cardiac malformations. A review by Hubrecht et al., published in 2016, suggested that risperidone may have a slight risk in this regard. Delays in motor development. Again, as with antidepressants, it is important to note that the above risks are not consistent findings, and there are contradictory studies, with some studies suggesting these risks while others conclude that these risks are not raised. And again, as with antidepressants, even in studies showing an increase in relative risks, the absolute risks are still quite low. But it is important for clinicians to realize that this is still an evolving field. Among the commonly used antipsychotics, the rate of drug passage via the placenta is highest for olanzapine, intermediate for risperidone and haloperidol, and lowest for quetiapine. Usual side effects of antipsychotics like drowsiness and extrapyramidal side effects can occur in the infant depending on the drug level that is reached in breast milk. Typical antipsychotics like haloperidol and clopromazine pass only in marginal levels into breast milk. Among the atypicals, amisulpiride passes into breast milk at high levels, risperidone and aripiprazole pass at intermediate levels, while olanzapine and quetiapine pass into breast milk at low levels. Breastfeeding is contraindicated in women taking clozapine due to the risk of agranulocytosis and seizures in the infant. Lithium use in the first trimester has been linked to a small increase in the risk of a rare cardiac abnormality called Epstein's anomaly. Epstein's anomaly is characterized by a downward displacement of the tricuspid valve into the right ventricle and hypoplasia of the right ventricle. An atrial septal defect or a patent foramen ovale are also usually present. Lithium use in pregnancy may also be associated with polyhydramnios and large for date babies. Lithium use in late pregnancy may be associated with diabetes insipidus, thyroid dysfunction, hypotonia, cardiac rhythm abnormalities, etc. in the newborn. Lithium passes into breast milk in significant amounts, so breastfeeding is contraindicated in women taking lithium to avoid the risk of lithium toxicity in the infant. This is a pictorial representation of Epstein's anomaly. The left image shows a normal tricuspid valve and a normal sized right ventricle. The right image shows Epstein's anomaly, in which there is a downward displacement of the tricuspid valve leaflets and the right ventricle is also smaller. Lithium levels are about 25% lower in the first trimester, 35% lower in the second, and 20% lower in the third trimester compared to pre-pregnancy lithium levels for the same dose. On the other hand, lithium levels are about 10% higher in the early postpartum period compared to pre-pregnancy lithium levels for the same dose. During pregnancy and early postpartum, it is important to monitor lithium levels along with serum creatinine more frequently than usual. So do this monthly till week 34, then do it weekly till delivery, and then twice weekly for the first 2 weeks postpartum. Also check the thyroid function at least once every trimester. If possible, avoid potential nephrotoxic drugs like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and aminoglycosides in pregnant women who are taking lithium. More frequent ultrasound monitoring of the fetus is also recommended. Anti-epileptic drugs commonly used as mood stabilizers are valproate, carbamazepine, and lamotrigine. The first two drugs have been around for decades, and most of the data on teratogenic effects come from patients with epilepsy taking these two drugs. Teratogenicity from lamotrigine is not as well established, but safety has also not been fully ensured in this regard. The main teratogenic risk with the anti-epileptic drugs is neural tube defect. Teratogenicity of anti-epileptic drugs may be dose-related. Folic acid supplementation, 5 mg daily, is recommended during pregnancy and in all women of childbearing age taking anti-epileptic drugs to try to reduce the risk of neural tube defects. Neural tube defects are congenital anomalies of the brain or spinal cord. Normally, the neural tube from which the brain and spinal cord develop closes during the first month of pregnancy. If the neural tube does not fully close, it results in a neural tube defect. The most common neural tube defect is spina bifida, followed by anencephaly. The risk of spina bifida is increased at least tenfold by valproate and about threefold by carbamazepine. Valproate use in the first trimester is also associated with risk of cardiac abnormalities such as atrial septal defect, cleft palate, polydactyly, hypospadias, etc. In view of all these risks, if possible, avoid valproate in women of childbearing age who are not taking contraception. This is a pictorial representation of spina bifida, and there are three types: spina bifida occulta, meningocele, and myelomeningocele. And this is a pictorial representation comparing normal brain and anencephaly. Valproate use in pregnancy has also been associated with later problems in the child, including lower IQ at school, autistic spectrum disorders. Carbamazepine and lamotrigine do not appear to have these risks. Among these three drugs, valproate passes the least into breast milk and lamotrigine the most. Infants may experience side effects from the drug taken by the mother, both dose-related side effects such as sedation, as well as idiosyncratic side effects like Stevens-Johnson syndrome that can occur rarely with lamotrigine. Benzodiazepines taken during the first trimester may slightly increase the risk of congenital malformations like cleft lip and cleft palate. Benzodiazepines taken during pregnancy may also be associated with psychomotor developmental delays in the offspring. Zolpidem, a commonly used hypnotic, may be associated with risks of preterm births and low birth weight babies. When taken in the postpartum period, sedatives and hypnotics may cause side effects such as excessive sleepiness and lethargy in the breastfeeding infant. Electroconvulsive therapy is not contraindicated in pregnancy. However, potential adverse effects of ECT, which might also include effects of the anesthetic and muscle relaxant medication used, may include fetal cardiac arrhythmias, vaginal bleeding, uterine contractions, miscarriage, premature labor, and status epilepticus, which might lead to fetal death. When used appropriately, ECT can be a life-saving treatment. We will now go through five multiple choice questions based on the material that we have covered so far. Question 1. Which of the following is correct regarding EPDS? I have given four options. Please go through the options and select your choice. If you want, you can pause. And the correct answer is D. EPDS, which is Edinburgh Postnatal Depression Scale, is a screening tool that is used both in pregnancy and the postpartum. It is the most commonly used scale to screen for depression in pregnancy and the postpartum. Question 2. Which of the following has not been associated with reduced fertility in females? Schizophrenia, anorexia nervosa, treatment with carbamazepine, or treatment with sodium valproate? And the correct answer is C. Treatment with carbamazepine. Treatment with carbamazepine has actually been associated with unplanned pregnancies due to reduced effectiveness of contraceptives because of its hepatic enzyme induction. Question 3. Which of the following is correctly paired? There are four options. Please go through the options and select your choice. And the correct answer is B. Postpartum psychosis has onset within the first 2 weeks of the postpartum period. A is false because spontaneous remission within a few days occurs with maternity blues. C is false because neural tube defects are associated with the use of anti-epileptic drugs in the first trimester. And D is false because use of SSRIs in pregnancy has been associated with persistent pulmonary hypertension in the newborn. Question 4. Which of the following is correct regarding the use of lithium in pregnancy and postpartum? There are four options. Please go through the options and select your choice. If you want, you can pause at this stage. The correct answer is C. for the same dose, lithium levels are significantly lower in pregnancy than in the postpartum. A is false because breastfeeding is contraindicated in mothers taking lithium because of the risk of lithium toxicity in the neonate. B is false because Epstein's anomaly is a congenital cardiac defect affecting the tricuspid valve. And D is false because it is the use of valproate in pregnancy that has been linked to an increased risk of autistic spectrum disorders in the offspring. The final question, which of the following is characteristic of postpartum psychosis? And the correct answer is acute onset. So postpartum psychosis is characterized by an acute onset. B is false because in about two-thirds of patients with postpartum psychosis, the psychotic symptoms are mood incongruent. C is false because generally postpartum psychosis has an excellent prognosis with most patients achieving remission. And D is false because postpartum psychosis is a psychiatric emergency that needs active treatment. That brings us to the end of this presentation. Hope you found the information useful. Thank you for watching.